introduction. I've known Monica Young for many, many years. I've seen her wear so many different hats and so much success. She is the founder of Blue Key Management, a boutique entertainment management, production, and publishing firm representing all areas of music, film, TV, and video. Some of her clients are director Matthew Cherry, who just recently won an Oscar for the amazing movie Hair Love. He also directed my summertime anthem movie, a video over probably 10 years ago or close to that. Also one of my favorite singers in Dombey and so many others. Monica Young, how are you doing?
I am amazing. I'm amazing. And
I love it.
I'm like amazing most of the time. How are you?
Same thing, man. I'm amazing. I'm really handling this quarantine, handling all these things the best that I can. And you are first and foremost a manager.
Yes.
And I've seen you do this job so well, but it's also just managing of overall things, but you have multiple clients. So my first question will be, what draws you in to someone? What makes you say, this is somebody I want to take on their business, take on that person to carry them to the next place?
I think the first thing is like believing in them. And I'm attracted to people who are storytellers. So when we talk about me and representing clients in music, film, and television, the thing they have in common is that they all tell great stories. So I've always been attracted to great songwriters. Even in music videos, I've never was attracted to like the blingy videos, but someone who could tell the story like within the video beginning to end, filmmakers or films, documentaries. So I think that storytelling, and then also I would say if I think I can be of value to them and my style matches their needs. So you know, all of us have different styles and clients have different needs. So there has to be synergy there.
So what are some of the basics of management in that aspect? So, of course, we understand managing time, which I hope we get some time to talk about. But I guess it's something different. You have to learn to listen, I guess, first.
Yeah.
How much of it is you aggressively putting together a platform? How do you know when to push and pull for different clients?
You know, each client, I would say, is different. So what I do, the first thing I do is sit down with someone. And again, look, let me just say this for the record. I'm very slow to take on a client. I take months because I bring them into a family. So it's sort of like courting and then dating. And then the marriage is actually the signing for me. It is. So it takes time. And I like to get to know people personally. And I listen to vision a lot. What is your vision and can I help you realize it? Because it's not my vision, it's the client's vision. And if I can help them realize it. So I look at me as a facilitator. And then sometimes that vision changes. So we have to make adjustments along the way. Like you said, you know what, Monica, I'm thinking this. But even when you have a client that sort of veers off the vision, you bring them back to the center and say, well, was this your vision or did it change? You know, so you keep them on track with their own vision. They're like, yeah, you're right. Monica, you're right. Or they say, you know what, Monica, it's shifted a little bit. I'm like, okay, let's rock that in that direction. So
you are a manager for mostly music for most of the time that I knew you. Mm-hmm. And then you started managing in the film realm as well. Mm-hmm. Let's first talk about just what was the difference and how was it beneficial knowing music, the music side, bringing that into the film side?
Well, I'll tell you how I started with going from music to film. I started working with music video directors. And that's sort of in between is music, but it's also sort of film. So that was like the segue. And it was very organic. So when you work with people who are natural storytellers, what you learn is that they're really filmmakers at heart and they love storytelling. So they're not music, they're not singers, they're actually filmmakers.
Right.
So it was a natural progression for us to go in that direction.
So Matthew Cherry, I guess you saw that direction. You saw that shift, that change.
Yes. Yeah, I saw the shift. And I asked him, like, I remember I met Matthew on the set of a Kindred video. And I became like an unofficial whip cracker for him. And he kept coming back for more. I guess he needed it. And I saw something in him. He's a professional athlete. And I was attracted to the work ethic. Like I had never seen anything like it. He had this vibrato. I can do anything. I can do it. And it comes from playing in the NFL. an elite athlete at the highest level. So he thought he could do anything. He knows how filmmaking is an ultimate collaboration. So he was really great with working with a team and knowing his position and not that it's all about him. And he was coachable. Those are the three things I look for. He's extremely coachable. So I've noticed that I haven't represented other people that played in the NFL, but I work with other athletes at, who've played professional sports. And I've seen that consistent, those three things, the work ethic. They think they can do anything. Nothing stops them. The coachability and the team, like the team spirit of understanding their role and everybody has a position.
Yeah.
So it's something that I really look for in any client.
Yeah. It's great you say about Matthew. Yes, he was a wide receiver for the NFL and he's coachable. That's the one thing that I was looking at that word. I heard a podcast just recently where they were talking about how some of the greatest people in the world, some of the greatest actresses and actors, Meryl Streep, Denzel Washington, to the star athletes, LeBron James, Michael Jackson, all Michael Jordan, all had coaches. Mm-hmm. So why don't we look for coaches to help us go to the next level? If the top level has people directing them and coaching them, then we should do that as well. And that's a good sign that, Matthew Cherry, he knew that side. So when he saw you be Shay tough love, he leaned towards it,
He absolutely did.
So let's talk about black hair. Like the idea first, that did you know it was going to work? Was it a shot in the dark? You guys won an Oscar on this movie.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? How amazing. But was it something that immediately was working from the gate? Tell me about the ups and downs in getting that from point A to point B.
Matthew had the idea. He came to me in early 2016. He calls me on the phone. He goes, "Hey, Mon, I have an idea. If we do it right, we can win an Oscar." It was that simple. It was that simple.
I love
4
it.
Years ago.
I love it.
A little more. He's like, "I have," and then it kind of went away. So, took a few meetings with a few companies, and you're talking about, "Hey, I have this idea about a black dad doing his daughter's hair for the first time," and people. And I want to do animation, and people are kind of like, I'll tell you this, the first time he says something to me, I said, "That's a children's book. We should do an accompanying children's book with it." So we launched a Kickstarter campaign. This is July 2017. And we come from an indie world. We're okay with self-publishing, drawing pictures ourselves, whatever it takes, So we do the Kickstarter campaign. At the time, Matthew was working for Jordan Peele, his company, and he launches it. He set it up. He takes off to work. Before he gets from South LA to Hollywood, we raised over $5,000 by just sharing it and going away. Like within, I'm talking about 30, 40 minutes, $5,000. Wow. With no, it was like, whoa, what happened here? Actually, this is before sharing it. This is just purely from people who are on Kickstarter looking for projects.
Wow.
And we had some great initial art from an illustrator named Vashti Harrison out of New York. And I think people really responded to the story. They hadn't seen anything like that. But with Matthew, he's really on the pulse of things on social media. He saw that those videos, like actual videos on YouTube, went viral. So he thought it'd be cool. And also, I mean, he thought it'd be like, we can earn an Oscar. And, we've always been unconventional in our approach. And I believe from day one, I'd never questioned it. It was just, yes, let's do it. And we're going to get that Oscar. So my job was, we have no experience in animation. How do I surround us with people who know, and we know story, but we don't know animation. So how do I surround us with people who know animation? And that's what we did.
Once again, finding that team. That's right.
Team. Yep.
So you are one of the best managers I know. I've watched you work many a times. Let's just talk about managing time. Right now, even in quarantine, yesterday when we talked, you were saying just Zoom meeting after Zoom meeting.
Mm-hmm.
How? And we talked about this other thing. I need to bring it up now because it's an important word. Your bandwidth.
Yes.
Knowing your personal bandwidth, knowing your client's bandwidth, how do you manage that time? For those who are managers, those who are looking for managers that are actually watching us and could really use this understanding of managing time.
Yeah, it's funny. I know when we were talking yesterday, you said I used the word three times, and I do use it a lot because, you know, when you manage there, I always say there's a larger pool of talent than there are of talented managers. There's a shortage, particularly black managers, and I'd like to see more people get into management and producing. So bandwidth is something I'm very conscious of. Like I can be a fan of the work, but I'm very conscious of my bandwidth and if I can take you on as a client. And I try to keep a very small team because I'm very hands-on. It because I manage people and I also manage projects, which is a part of, you know, producing as well. I don't have a simple answer for that. I kind of just instinctively know, and every day it's a struggle to figure it out. I'll be honest, it's not that simple, but I don't like taking on people or projects that I don't feel that I feel I can do. If I don't feel I can be of service and I become a disservice or just it's stagnant, I will not do it. I have to be very certain that I can add value to your team and to your career. That's a really important thing to me, just personally, and you know, my reputation here.
Of course, of
So
course.
I care deeply about that. I care deeply about careers and you know, I sometimes, you know, I may refer it to another manager or I'm always, you know, give advice, but I'm very, very clear about I just don't have the bandwidth for it. And that's projects included. So
Listen, I'm so using that bandwidth for it now. It makes so much
love
sense.
it. Yeah.
I might use it with my kids later on today.
I don't
Can
have
y'all
the bandwidth.
not? My bandwidth is not wide enough for me to
Right.
handle you outside right now. We
You
gonna
know
stay.
what's so funny, Eric? My friends are like just sort of locally, we use that word all the time, all of us on the management and producing side. That's just something. Oh, I don't have the bandwidth. So I guess it's just a thing we do here.
When you said it yesterday, I mean, when I say it clicked, so I understood it so well. I mean, it made so much sense. Like Sweet Life said in the comments, that bandwidth is the new word of the day. Listen, everybody, understand, take a minute to learn your bandwidth
Yes.
and unapologetically live what that
That is,
reception is, you
yeah,
know?
especially like with young people and millennials. I'm a Generation Xer, so I think like when me coming up, I felt like it was a bad word to do multiple things. Now we call it multi-hyphenated and embrace it. Before you see a business card, it's like, oh, they do 10 things. They're the, you know, the master of none, you know, if you will. So now it's like really cool. And I've even embraced that as long as it fits within, you know, a certain boundaries of what I think I'm good at and passionate about. So you know, it's bandwidth, multi-hyphenated, I think is really cool right now. I think that's important. And not just it, you know, I think our parents, you do one thing for 30, 40 years, but now we're in a different place, which I think is really cool. And embracing it, I think with the millennials and you know, it's a really cool thing.
Indeed. You said several things that sparked something for me. I noticed we talked yesterday where you said you started your own publishing company,
Yes.
and it said that now you're moving into producing as well. So we talk a lot, at least I talk a lot about building your own platform. And you've been one who's managed and supported so many people's platforms. Tell us a bit about this transition of you moving into your own platform and developing that now.
I mean, look, it's one of those things when you're a manager, you're an agent, you're a lawyer, you see residual and royalty checks come in for your clients. And the older you get, you're like, hey, okay, I need to really think about how can I make that kind of money in my sleep. You know, I'm serious. You know, so you know, I've actually seen cases. I've seen managers, attorneys, lawyers get fired and help build careers. I mean, I can think of
Of
someone
course.
that's pretty, you know. And I've seen people actually. I remember one person passing away. A man. I mean, an artist, and then the whole team that built that career, the family just say, okay, you're out of the picture. And so it really got me to thinking about, okay, I need to revisit sort of my model here. And one thing that's really important to me is building my own intellectual property. So whether that, like, you know, whether it's, I want my own residuals, I want my own royalty and residuals. And that's not to say I'm going to go be a songwriter or director, but So now I've developed and I'm developing more partnerships with my clients. So like we're right now developing a television show. Instead of being a traditional commission manager, I am an executive producer where I have my own line item, and I'm locked in the project for life, just like my client. The same with publishing. So that those are conversations like with new clients I have, like, look, are you open to this? And it's not every project, but I need to be locked in a project just as much as, like, I'm really doing the work to help create this, and I should be entitled to ownership of it.
Right.
You know, and not everything. It just has to make a lot of sense. But that means, like, when you do something like that, a lot of times the client is happy because they recognize you're doing the work. And also, now they're not being commissioned.
Right.
An online item, and it's really considered double dipping. And you're making just as much as them when you do that.
Right.
So, yeah. And then same thing with the publishing. My business partner, Banch Abigail, she's a manager. She was at Adam Factory with Troy Carter for years. She, when Troy dismantled his management company, she took Kamasi Washington and went on her own. And then we co-managed a client together. And then we formed a publishing company where we have a larger company, Big Deal Music, who is our partner. So look at us more like the A&Rs of it. And they handle all the back end. They do all the advances and things like that. So it's really cool. And then we add more of a personal touch to this with the songwriters.
That's beautiful.
That's just like another arm. Yeah. So
how many arms do you have?
Not many arms. Like for that, actually, we're going to hire someone. We'll bring someone on for that. Like, yeah.
I love it.
So, yeah.
So real quick, how has these producing and this platform helped you with your management and vice versa? I guess these things cross in understanding or improving you, I guess.
To me, managing a person's career is you tend to manage their projects too. Look, I got into producing out of necessity. We were working on web series and we were doing music videos and we didn't have the money to bring someone else on. So I did it just because there was no one else. And I learned, you know, when we had money or could get people, but I really had to fill in. And then I noticed just like I found myself, people noticed that I cared about project first. I didn't care about personalities. I cared about a quality project. Like, and I was the one to keep that focus. Like, it's about project. Let's get it done. Let's make it great. So I was always that, you know. So I think managing a project is very, managers manage people. It's an easy thing to generalize it to project management. It's essentially project management. And do you have to know everything? No. Do I know every aspect to producing? No. Do I know how to bring a line producer in that can break down the script and come up with a budget? Absolutely. Do I know how to read a budget? Yes. So that when you notice on projects, you have multiple managers that specialize in various things. Personally, me, I'm probably more of an overview person, big picture person. I like to go find the checks. That's sort of me. Go find the money, put together an amazing team. I don't consider myself a physical producer. Like, you know, I'm not going to go look, oh, let me go find the right locations. If I know it, sure. I mean, I've shot my place many a times. I can go, like, if we need something, but generally I'm sort of the bigger picture. You know, I don't even touch budgets. Like, again, it's about a team. So if there's an issue with the budget, I only let one person get into, like, in the budget. I may have suggestions or say this, but I say you control it, don't touch it. Because when you have multiple people in a budget, things get confusing. One person share that. We can talk to them, but I don't even do it, even though I'm usually in charge. That's your thing. So again, goes back to the whole team thing and knowing your position.
Cutting back, I see assumptions is the devil of business.
Right.
So yeah, that makes complete sense.
Yeah.
I'm gonna do one little thing for all those who are watching. If you have a question for Monica, please start putting a comment. We're gonna have some time to let you get those questions in if we have time as well. But it's worth starting to put those in there now. Real quick, we are celebrating Juneteenth this weekend. How has your celebration of Juneteenth, how important has this holiday been for you?
So funny. Like, I had a long conversation. I think for me, it's been really reflective of my ancestors. I am really, really obsessed with history. And I'm a natural social scientist. And I'm obsessed with genealogy. So I've been collecting photographs for years and years. Like, just, yeah, and trying to figure out what to do with them. So for me, it's been really reflective of the ancestors. I spent a few hours yesterday. I'm on Ancestry. I did my DNA test, just sort of doing more research and honoring them. Yeah, it's exciting. I encourage everyone. I did it. So funny. I did the DNA test to connect with more relatives that I actually met a year and a half ago. I mean, our parents are first cousins and we never met each other and never knew of each other.
Wow.
So, yeah, in Oregon and Washington State. So last Thanksgiving, we all came together. So I think, you know, we have a big text message chat. So we spent a lot of time as a family reflecting and talking, you know, amongst each other on in the chat. So, you know, I think our history is so funny. I think Black American history is, I look at it as a very contemporary culture. The most dynamic culture, and I'm honestly daily in awe of who we are and what we've done. Sometimes I'm driving and I'm like, I'm in awe of like it's incredible what we've been able to do with so little, and the world is influenced by who we are. So it was just definitely a day of you know, spending the time reflecting, talking to friends who care as deeply as I do. And yesterday I posted about my great grandfather who was born enslaved. That's not far away. I talked to my mom. I was like, your grandfather was born a slave.
Right.
That's really close.
Yeah.
You know, so I, you know, had a time, you know, really great conversation with her about it. I'm happy that more people, it seems like I went to the bank yesterday and it was closed at 1 for Juneteenth. I was like, okay, things are changing. I was like, wow, it was closed. I got there at 2. So yeah. I'm happy that it's growing and it's being acknowledged, you know, and hopefully it will turn into a national holiday.
Rightfully so. Yeah. I think it's adding to a lot of much needed change.
Yeah.
I was talking to an artist the other day, and I'll say it in a careful, kid-friendly way. We were saying how they threw crap at us, mm-hmm. and we used it as fertilizer.
Yeah.
And that fertilizer, we planted a tree, and that tree bared fruit. And out of that fruit, we made a pie that we served to the world with love. And it's crazy. It's like from such a horrible place that we could grow to so many heights. But I think it's very important that we pay homage to the ancestors that we can name and those we can't name.
Because
that's the sad part of all this. There's a lot of records lost. As well. Once again, guys, if you have some questions for Monica before we tie up, we're turning around the corner, and Monica, you've been amazing. So do you have any future projects that you can tell us a little bit about? If certain things, I know most of it is probably top secret, but anything that you're excited, about that you're working on now that
I'm going to announce it. It hasn't come out yet, but I can say it because the deal's done. We have Hair Love. As you guys know, we earned an Oscar, and we have a series.
Yes.
That's coming out on HBO Max. We have a partnership with Sony. It's called Young Love.
Love it.
Hence my name, Monica Young. So it's the Young family, and they're a young millennial couple. So yeah. And I didn't name it that. Matthew did. I was like, that's so sweet. You know, I really am. It's like, you know, so
I love it.
Yeah, we have that. And we have a big animation feature that I really can't talk about just yet. I hate saying that stuff, but so silly. But yeah, we have an animation feature. We have, and a really cool athletic miniseries on a high profile athlete. So I'm excited. And the show will be very musical. It's going to a lot of music, a lot of what we call discovery music or non-mainstream music, or that doesn't get us just due. Matthew and I care deeply about that. So definitely be, I'm looking for a music supervisor now. Looking for a lot of things, but that's probably the big thing. And a composer.
Well, let me know where I need to fill out my application. Amen. No, but congratulations. Yeah. Guys, you heard it here first on Bryceland Entertainment Experience Mixer for Visionaries.
Yes, thank you so much.
Congratulations. You know, I know that you guys are working on so much, and there's probably a million other things that you can't talk about right now, but I really appreciate you trusting and everyone watching here today about this great new information. Just much love, Monica. You know, like I said, it's probably been 20 plus years. Yeah. I've watched you work.
Yeah.
And you've been amazing. I've taken notes and so appreciate everything. Any last nuggets you have for anybody out there? Any last closing parts of Word of Wisdom?
Let me think about say that real fast. I'll be honest. Like I asked you, like, who is the audience? I didn't even know, like, and I guess I know you hit me to it. Like, who are we talking to? So it's hard to say. I'll just say this. If you have any questions, you can hit me up. I'm on all the social media. You can hit me, Monica at bluekeymanagement.com. That's probably best. It's hard. I'm not 100% clear on if I know the audience. If I may say something, they're like, well, that's not wisdom. We know that already. I don't know.
You never know. And at the same time, they might be, okay, two people might know, but the rest of them might not know. But and they say this is a mixer for visionaries. Say the email one more time. And are you on Instagram, Facebook as well?
Instagram, Monica A. Young. Twitter, I think Monica_A. Young, because I wasn't available. Facebook, Monica A. Young, and email Monica at bluekeymanagement, all spelled out, .com. I'll just say this. I guess the quick parting words are like, and I don't know, I doubt if people are there, but I'll say it anyway. Just try new things and be diverse in what you do. I think for me, like I said, if you're interested in music, think about film, and if you're interested in film, think about music, because what I love is the integration of those mediums. You can't watch a commercial without hearing music or sound or some type of composition. So all interconnected. So when you think about whatever you're doing, think about the other sort of things that are interconnected with it, and learn those areas as well. And you will stand out in a room. Very few people do that.
I agree. Well, you stand out in the room, whether you realize it or not, you know.
Great speaking with you.
Well, Monica, I appreciate your time. And on behalf of Anshia, the birthday girl, and Bryce,
thank you, Anshia.
We thank you, you know.
And happy birthday, Anshia. Appreciate you.
Yes.